been okay. It has been asked. It's not a horrible thing to do, but it seems that these days for me, last week I came. I was giving here a lecture after going to a funeral. Today also I've been in a funeral. It seems that it's following me, possibly as a good introduction to my lecture. Anyway, I just want to mention the name of the person. He will be mentioned by others for better reasons. It's a native now of Miami called Sammy Rohr, who was the father of a family that is. Well, the fact that they had money wasn't harmful, not to them, but they did also a lot of good things with the money, which is not always the case. Anyway, so now I'm trying to speak about somebody who is. I would put it in a way that it's a strange subject, because I'm speaking about a person that we know very little about. It's not just my personal ignorance that is the reason for it, but it is, we really know very little about that person. We, in so many ways, when you try to summarize everything that is known about him, it will take about 5 minutes to tell the story. Now, I choose him not because there's not too much material about him. That's not the real reason, but because in a certain way he is not symbolizes. He was an end of an era. And because being an end of an era, that's a part of the importance of the person. He was just the last person in a long era in history. And that is something that is important also to understand how things change, because some of the things that I've been speaking about, some of the people that I've been speaking about, they were people of different levels of importance. Some of them very important, some of them very creative, some of them people that opened up the gates of further development. Here I am speaking about a person who is, in a way, the end of the line. The end of the line. So in a certain way it means he is a symbol for an era that has been there and passed. There were attempts to recover it, but never again. That was Chizkiyah HaNasi, who lived in the, we know about roughly that he lived in the 11th century in Iraq, basically in Baghdad, in Iraq. We about from the, perhaps from 1020 to 1060 odd. That was his life. Now, Chizkiyah HaNasi was, in one hand, I mentioned before, the person who was also an end of the era, but not just an end, Rav Hai Gaon. Rav Hai Gaon, who was, as they call it, the last of the Gaonim, wasn't actually the last of them. He was the last important Gaon that everybody knew, and as I say, he was the last person, Rav Hai Gaon, who was perhaps never again a person who was the acknowledged leader of the Jewish people. Nobody else came to this position. There were many important leaders, rabbis, political leaders, poets and statesmen among the Jews, and some of them were very important and famous in their own realm, but they were known in their realm. Most of the people, even great people, that were so very important in our history, still in their lifetime, they were known not only within a certain area. It's not also, you just have to add to it, to imagine, among other things, that now with our means, enormously bigger means of communication. We have now what I call all kinds of electromagnetic information channels, telephone, telegraph, radio, television, and so on, internet. All these things make communication much easier. And more than that, travel, as practical it was also, is now, I mean, we cannot go all over the world in 24 hours, but we can, mostly, it's possible it can be done with some airplanes, but basically the world is much smaller now. Now in the past it wasn't like this, because places that it took months to go from one continent to the other. But as I'm saying, Rabbi Gaon was the person that was accepted and acknowledged by all the Jews in the world. Those who somehow came to hear about him, not all of them had any kind of a direct contact, but they knew about him, and therefore he was the leader, the Jewish leader, even a great person, and he was so exceptional in so many ways, like Maimonides. In his lifetime, he was known within a certain area, say, that went in the, say, between, the Middle East, some countries around it, Italy, south of France, and that was about that. Later on, his name, of course, spread and grew with the time. But at the time, for that time, he wasn't known all over the world, the Jewish world. And he was not accepted as the leader of the Jewish people, with all his greatness and with all the honor that people gave him. Now, I'm saying Rabbi Gaon was the last, but he was the last in the sense that he was the last leader of everybody. But he wasn't the last in the formal year. He wasn't the end of the line. And so after him, things remained in a certain way as usual, but not as usual. Which means the system didn't collapse. The system went on. And the system, at least in Babylonia, Iraq, was more or less the same basic system. It was the triple rulership of the two heads of the yeshivot, the yeshiva of Badita, yeshiva of Sura, and the Reish Galuta, the exilarch, who was the, so to say, the political leader of the Jews, and surely under the Muslim rule. So this was, and these three were usually sometimes in a loving connection. Sometimes they're fighting with each other, which is, again, happens among the best. And so, but basically it was a three-party. The rulership was a triumvirate. And this went on for many years. We don't know exactly how long it was, but at least it was something, a system that stayed more or less stable for more than perhaps 500 years. 500 years in any history is a sizable amount of time. And it was a combination of it wasn't purely spiritual power, because the heads of the yeshivot had also their own political power and even financial power. The head of the exilach was far more important politically than it was in knowledge. But basically, these three worked together to form a leadership of the Jews in at least in these countries, and in a certain way, it oozed from there to many other places. They were the leaders, even though there were local leaders everywhere. Now, there were many reasons, big political reasons, and general political reasons. There were also Jewish reasons, and some of them were also connected with something that I mentioned before, last time and before last time. See, there was a time when I would say that the bulk, the numbers, and surely the important leadership of the Jews were in Babylonia. This was the place where the biggest number of Jews lived, and which you had a Jewish community, a creative Jewish community, that was in a way leading all the others. The rest of the people were periphery. Some of them were living, as I say, in those times, say around the year 1000, there were Jews already in most parts of Western Europe. Jews were in Germany from the second century in Germany. Jews were living in France before it was called France. In fact, Jews came to Germany before the Germans came to Germany. The Germans came to Germany later, and when the Jews came there, they were Goths, Ostrogoths, West Goths, but they were not Germans. The Germans came in a way later. So Jews came there before. In France it was surely the same thing. The Jews came to France when it was Gallia, Gaul. The Franks, that made French, called this name, came much later. So Jews lived in France before the Frenchmen lived there. But anyway, Jews were there, and Jews were in Greece and Italy, and of course in Spain. So there were Jewish communities in Europe, and there were Jews in Egypt and in North Africa. But these Jewish communities they considered themselves, and they were practically, perhaps some of them did very well financially or in other ways, but culturally they knew that there is a center, and this is a center. It wasn't like Mitzion Tetzetua, but it was very, very similar to it. The center was from Surah and Pumbadita comes the Torah. And we, say in North Africa, or we in France, or we in any other country, we are just disciples. We receive their messages, we receive their orders, we receive their whatever they have to tell us to do. So it was for many years, and I say you spread slowly, sometimes willingly, because it seems that we have, as people, we have some kind of a certain bone, a certain nervous part of our nature is that we are not sitting very quietly in one place. We have something what they call itchy, and we move into other places. And in many times it was our choice. I mean, we were kicked out of so many, many places. I mean, the number of places from which Jews were exiled is huge, countries, cities, and so on. So Jews were exiled, and they fled into other places. So in about this year, there were already some beginning of a Jewish community in Ukraine. And some were living around in what are called Czechoslovakia or Czech, in Bohemia of the time. So there were Jews all over the world. But all these communities were not only small, but basically all the Jewish nation was at that time. The numbers were not very big, but basically they were peripheral, peripheral in influence, peripheral in knowledge, and they were just, they saw themselves as disciples, as followers of the big center, of the big leaders. But with the time, some of these places established some kind of, not only of identity or language, but they established something of a, let's say, their own culture. It grew slowly, not intentionally, because somebody, let's say that the Jews in that came in into the, it was not them, it was one big country, and the difference between France and Germany was unnoticed. But in the borderline, I say in the line between those places, there was a growing Jewish community. And this growing Jewish community began with sporadic writings of one person and another person, but it grew. And with the time, it got its own nature. See, I won't say that Jews became Frenchmen, but Jews became, unlike, let's say, the Jews in Mesopotamia and many other countries that spoke Arabic, those Jews had their jargon that was French. So the French jargon was a part, when Rashi wants to mention, to explain the word, he doesn't have really a Hebrew equivalent, or people don't know the Hebrew equivalent, he uses what are called the tongue of the language of the country, the lads of that country. So you have French there. Now, this French, incidentally, because historically speaking, most of the Ashkenazi Jews went to France in a certain period of time. We carried with us, as Ashkenazi Jews, we carried not only what I call some of the personality, some of the development, we carried also a part which was of the language. So we have little remnants of French in the Ashkenazi Jewry of all time. Now, you possibly, many Ashkenazi Jews never know that they speak French. But Choland is surely a French word, see? That's surely French. Choland is French. It's French. It's one of the things that came to us. And there are a number of proper names. I've written a little piece about it, that the name, if you know a Jewish name, a Yiddish name, that is, it remained mostly with women, but not only, a name like Gente. You possibly heard the name Gente. It is a name, it's a proper name. It's not a nickname or a funny name. It's a name, a real name. But that is, it remains still in France. It's a French name, basically. And in French now, it's just pronounced differently because the French changed the language. And because the French changed the language, now they call the same word, the same name, Gente, is now called in France, Jeannette. So if you see any Gente moving about you, you should know that she's really a French lady called Jeannette. And there are similar things like this. But what I mentioned it not just to tell you that there were things like this, but there was a beginning of a culture. And at those times, let's say, Rabbi Haigaon, or a little bit later after him, there were already people in France, or Germany, France, in the that were already important people, that were really leaders slightly, some of them in a political way, but also in a cultural way. Rabbeinu Gershom Me'or HaGola was about a contemporary of Rabbi Gaon. So there were the people there, there were people in Italy, and there were people, as I mentioned before, in North Africa and in Spain. So all these centers began to grow. And the center in the main, the old center in Babylonia, became in a certain way slightly less important. See, because they grew in all kinds of places. They began as, so to say, colonies, but they became independent. Independent spiritually, they were not dependent in other way, but they became independent spiritually and began to develop in sometimes slightly different ways, and sometimes in novel and exciting ways. See, that what happened later on, those years later, in the 11th century, 12th century, and 13th century, say in France, the huge Talmudic creativity of the place, which is, see, small communities, some of them of a few hundred people, these communities created giants. Somehow it doesn't happen in Israel today that every small community of 300 creates what they call literary scholarly giants. They usually created some what they call municipal corruption at best, but it doesn't create this kind of things. Rashi lived in a very small town, and so Rabbeinu Gershom that lived in say in Mainz, Magenta of those times, but also for the number of Jews were quite limited. But still they managed to create people there. And people of stature, of significant people that were there. So we are going back to the center in Babylonia. Now there was also something that happened there. It wasn't finished at the time, but Baghdad was for many years the capital city of the Muslim Empire. And even though there were some pieces that became independent, like Spain, and sometimes also Egypt, but mainly it was still the capital of a big empire. These places, as political centers, not for the Jews, but political centers for the country itself, the country also was becoming less and less alive. It was from corruption to just degeneration. So in those years, you have the big Muslim center there in Baghdad. It's no longer not the only one, and there are some foreign rulers that came in, the Seljuk, Khans and Sultans that came in, and they kept the old rulers as nominal heads of the government, as the Khalifa of whatever it was, but they were not. It was not the same for them. And there were new people. Some of them were Turkish people. Some of them were half combinations of Mongol and Turkish people that came into these places. And the big center, in a way, diminished in power. With that also was a diminishing in power of the Jewish center. The Jewish center that was. It wasn't completely dependent on being in the capital, but still, it had a connection. The Exilarch, Rosh HaGola, was practically, in one way or another, appointed or approved by the local king, local Muslim king. Later on, the local Muslim king was himself a figurehead. So he couldn't give so much power to the Rosh Gola. And even as rulers, you see, there's one of the things that happened in many countries. Weak rulers don't become more liberal. we rulers have the tendency to become more dictatorial, more cruel, and more stupid. It is a method that, I'm not going now to speak about politics, not only contemporary politics, but even about ancient politics. But there is a power, you see, when there is, you have small, minuscule kinds of people. You can't expect them to be extraordinary people in other ways. So everything becomes degenerated, and because of that, you see, I'm just speaking about the double things that happened. That on one hand, you had the political power of Baghdad diminished, and other centers became more and more powerful. In Spain and North Africa, they became practically independent. On the other hand, also among the Jews came, it happened the same thing. Many of the local leaders became, they grew in power, in stature. And I'm speaking about, you have now, it's not just by chance that we know, we have more and more names that we know about. Because these people were creative people. And so they left behind them books, poetry, some other things that were a part of a culture that grew up in all the outer parts of the Jewish world that became, after some time, they became the center. See, I spoke, one of my speeches was about that North Africa was for a time possibly the big center of the Jewish life. Later on, part of it went and grew up into the very, very big and important center in Spain. So this Spain became the center of the Jewish world. And the places like Egypt or Iraq became less important politically and Jewishly. Now, one of the problem points was, we know the name of the person who was Rosh HaGolah at the time, and that was Chizkiyahu ben David. He was the Rosh HaGolah at the time, just possibly even in the later years of Rabbi High Gaon. But at least he was there, and perhaps a young man, who was Rosh HaGolah. He didn't have the same power as his forefathers. As I say, he didn't have not the political backing of the government, and even the Jews, they diminished, and the Jews, he was the prince of the Jews. But if the Jews don't want to pay taxes to their prince, so the prince is not glorious as he was before, and so it was. But there was Rosh HaGolah, and was Chizkiyahu ben David. After the death of Rabbi High Gaon, it wasn't that there were no scholars. That he died and wisdom died with him immediately, in the same way. But what happened was something else. You had people, and sometimes, I'm just saying this as an aside, sometimes, historically speaking, when you have a very great man in every realm, he has a tendency, not intentional, but to overshadow almost everybody else. See, there is also a danger in having a very great leader or a very great spiritual leader or a political leader, because somehow, as they used to, the wording of it is in the Talmud, what can a candle do when the sun shines? A candle is not noticeable when there is sunshine. So when there is sunshine, you usually don't have rival suns. So you have one sun, And that is, it happens. It happens in many places. And political assurance, spiritual levels, that sometimes a very great man creates behind him some kind of a void. It happens sometimes in zoology, and sometimes in the botanics in the same way. A huge tree is sometimes so powerful that it doesn't allow other trees to grow to the same size. So there will be small trees, but there won't be something, some giants like this. It's a problem, and we can point to quite a number of people in history, Jewish and non-Jewish history. See, after a great man, there are what are called epigones. People that are not in the same size, not in the same bed. Now, the thing was, because Rav Haigaon wasn't, as they wrote about him, he was the last of the Geonim in time, but the first in importance. So after a man that was like this, that was ruling the Jewish community for directly and indirectly for about 60 years. So you can understand that somehow it is a matter of envy. But somehow other people don't have perhaps the initiative or the drive to become as big as they could. Anyhow, after Rav Haigaon, they really had a problem, which was he wasn't there. There was, again, they needed a person to, as a head of the yeshiva. And the only person that they could find was a person who was, by any means, everybody agreed he was an important scholar himself, and a person that could, if he would go in this direction, could perhaps become the Rosh Yeshiva of Upadita. But that was the same person, Chizkiah ben David. So this was the first and perhaps the only time in Jewish history that you had the two positions were united in one hand. The Rosh Gola, Chizkiah ben David, was also the Rosh Yeshiva. So it never happened before, because first of all there were distinct demands from these people, and in many cases, I mean, look, the Rosh Yeshiva was not necessarily a political leader, or able or knowledgeable about politics so deeply. The Rosh Agola that grew up as a prince was not always a scholar. Some of them were scholarly, some of them were very nice people, some of them were just corrupt sons of important fathers. So in many cases it wasn't the same thing. That you see, it was rarely that you could find a person who was what they used to call it, the point about it was historically they said that from the times of Moshe Rabbeinu to the time of Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi in Eretz Israel, the compiler, the author of the Mishnah, there wasn't Torah u'gdula b'makom echad, meaning Torah and greatness, not gdula in the sense of greatness in a different way, but greatness about political power, political leadership. It was never in one hand. You had the king and the prophet, the king and the high priest. Now, when Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi came, he was again, he was the political head of the Jews in Eretz Israel. He was also the greatest scholar. So we had again something that had all these things. They said the same thing later in the Talmud, that many years later, Rav Ashi, who was the man that basically created the Babylonian Talmud, was again a person like this. He was the political and religious leader of the people in one person. But again, since that, those times, there were the political leaders, I mentioned one of them, say, Bustanai, but there were many others, that some of them see, it would be a nice story to tell, even though we have even less material about it, about Marzutra Reish Galuta, who was the exilar many years before, and he made a revolt against the king of Persia. And for about 7 years, he had almost an independent state in Iran. So there were some things like this, but again, he was perhaps an important person, not a scholar. He was a leader. He was many other things, but he wasn't a scholar. Now, when it came to Hezekiah ben David, Hezekiah Nasi, he was the person that could have. He was knowledgeable enough, and enough about that. It's not just evidence from others, but we have some. See, some of his letters at least remained. There are not very many of them, and some of them were found only later in the Gniza and in other places. But you could see from his letters and from the exchange of letters that people, contemporaries, wrote to him that he was a great scholar. And so they chose him to be the head of the yeshiva from Padita, which was in many ways, not historically, but it was practically the most important yeshiva of the time. So it was again the same person was, when I mentioned the Torah Gdula b'makom echad, it was not sometimes they used to say the same things not as in a funny way, but sometimes when you had in some shtetl, you have the local gvir who was also able to read and write, they would say, you know, exaggerate and say, that's Torah Gdula b'makom echad. See, the Torah was not impressive, and the Gdula was even less impressive. But again, in some places, when you have this kind of flattery, that's just useful. But in this case, it was Hezekiah Nasi wasn't the same size of Rav Ashi. He wasn't the same as a comparative size. He was a scholar of some importance, and he could have his balakol. He could make his piskei dinim like any other Rosh Yeshiva. So he could be a Rosh Yeshiva, and many of the Rashi Yeshivot in Babylonia, including Rav Haig Gaon, they really came from the family of the exilach. They were descendants of great grandsons or great grandsons of a person who was the exilach. But they, as one of them says, we moved from politics into Torah. So they didn't get involved in political rule, but they were involved in studying Torah. They became important in this field, which is it doesn't happen to many people, but sometimes it may happen that a son of a person who comes from a noble family, instead of becoming, say, making money and wasting money, becomes an important person in other things. Just if you know, there is a family that lives mostly they live in, say, the border, you know, on the borders of Italy, Switzerland, and France, mostly from Switzerland, the family of a prince de Broglie. He was a prince, an Italian prince, and for three or four generations, some of his children, grandchildren, so all became some of the most important physicists of the time. So sometimes a person can begin as a prince, See, but nobody cares about his being depressed. But because he's important, he will not remember because he was a prince, insignificant prince. But he was a great scientist. So in that sense, there were those people in our history that went from the rule of the exilarch to become the heads of the yeshivot were people that made the choice. They are not interested in the political life, they are interested in the intellectual life. So they went there. Now, Chizkiyah ben David was able to do it, but he remained also the exilarch. So, as I say, he's again one of the last people that had this kind of a combination, not of some power, but he was officially the head of the he was the head of the Jewish community on both sides, on the political side and on the scholarly side. Now, we don't know exactly what happened, but the end of it was abrupt and tragic. For some reason, that is, surely we don't have enough. You see, the Jews didn't always go into repeating what the authorities said about it, and it wasn't always important for the non-Jewish rulers to speak about it. Chizkiyah Rosh HaGolah, or Chizkiyah Reish Galut, Chizkiyah Nasi, Chizkiyah was the Rosh Yeshiva. He was accused of treason. Was accused of treason. He and his sons were taken to the king that wasn't really a real king, but he had enough power to do it. They were tortured and they were killed. They were killed. So we know about the time. So it's about, let's say, about 1060. Now, killing them, and that's why I mentioned it, the fact that the Jewish leaders, religious leaders, political leaders, were killed by the non-Jews is not rare. It happened before. But you see, it wasn't just the fact that he was killed. He was killed, but with him was killed not just that there was no... There are some notions that possibly one of his sons somehow escaped. So he had a son that survived after him, and perhaps also descendants that came after. It's not always clear, but there is a chance that there was a son and perhaps grandchildren from this line. But basically, they killed the what called Chizkiyah Nasi, and that was in many ways the end of a period, the real end of the period. He was practically, even though again, the thing diminished, never stopped altogether, but he was practically the last Rosh Gola, the last man that fulfilled this job. They no longer, the authorities were not interested, and perhaps the Jewish community was also not interested in having a political leader. So there was no longer a Rosh Gola, but with him also collapsed the yeshiva of Upadita and the yeshiva of Sura. But all these things that survived for, they used to say that the yeshiva of Upadita in one way or another, in one guise or another, was from the time of the exile to Babylonia, which is, it means that it was living for about 1500 years, but it stopped. It stopped. Those two yeshivot were destroyed, and the Rosh Gola, the position of the Rosh Gola was destroyed. Now, as I say, It was because even the rule of the in the Muslim world was also not settled. Nobody knew there was an official ruler who was not ruling, and there was a practical ruler who was ruling but didn't have the authority, and the country was crumbling in many ways, going up and down. And so in the last, something like a big animal that dies in the last throes of its life, it perhaps unintentionally damages other living creatures around it. So this thing that collapsed, and it was again and again there were the Seljuk and there were the Ayyubi rulers that came forth about the they were called the dead body of the empire reviving it later. Then came the Mongols with Genghis Khan and destroyed almost everything that was in the Far East, I say the call, and they also in the Middle East, and they claimed they were wonderful good at destroying things, and so they did it in many places all over the world, and they destroyed. See, I'm not going again. It would be a political and cultural statement. There is a chance that their visitation in the East, Iran, Iraq, and so on, was possibly what, in a way, stopped, not completely. It didn't stop completely, but in a way, see, I would put it in a way that there was a time, up to those years, when the Muslim culture was the most advanced culture in the world. Europe was a barbarian place. The science and knowledge and literature and so on was far more, it was a much higher level in the Muslim world. The Mongol occupation was possibly killed the centers of knowledge, centers of learning in their place, see? And perhaps it didn't recover yet. It's about 700 years, but it didn't recover yet properly from that blow. They are no longer the leaders of the world. They are still some of the Arab, the Muslim rulers, and the Muslim people are still good as killers, but they're not very good, not as soldiers, and also not as, I would put it as the creators of the leaders of the culture of the world. See, if you look about this, so many of the terms that are used even in modern times are Arab terminology. See, alchemy, and from this chemistry comes from basically from Arab words. The title of admiral is an Arab title. Basically, it's just changed a little bit, and algebra is called algebra because of after the name of a Muslim scholar. See, so they were the leaders of the world. They were, but I'm saying it was destroyed. Now, this destruction, the corruption of the place, also was a destruction of the center there. So, if let me just add, after Hezekiah HaNasi, there were still attempts to revive the yeshiva, but it was no longer Pumbadita or Surah. They had some kind of yeshiva in Baghdad. It has its ups and downs. It's one of the ups was in the time of the contemporary of the Rambam, Rav Shmuel ben Eli Gaon, who was a very powerful person, but he also lived, that's what I said, he lived in the wrong time. To be a contemporary and a competitor of the Rambam, it wasn't a good position. See, look, if as they say, the moon always complains. That's when the sun shines. Nobody sees the moon. It's not very much. So, incidentally, just for the ladies here, the daughter of Rav Shmuel Ben Eil Gaon, because he had no sons, his daughter took over. And so the most of sometimes, in the beginning, say, of the, in the 12th century, 13th century, there was a Rosh Yeshiva, a woman, in Baghdad. And she wrote a letter, and the letter remained. She describes how she's teaching everybody in the yeshiva, and she's doing everything that her father used to do. Because she said, my father didn't teach me anything except Torah. That's the only thing that I know, and I'm doing it as much as I can. But it's a game. It doesn't mean that it was the greatness. It was a time. There were some people, Rosh Hagola disappeared. But there was no longer a real Rosh Hagola. But there were people that were descendants of Rosh Hagola. Some of them lived in Eretz Israel. And they claimed all kinds of honors. Sometimes they got the honors, but without any real power. Some of them came to Egypt. And again, they claimed all kinds of honors. And some of them went to Provence. And again, they had some kind of honors. And so many other places like this. It was really splinters of something great. There was no longer a real Rosh Hagola in the world. There was no longer a yeshiva of Padita. There was no longer a yeshiva of Surah. This died. And he died with the time of Chizkiyah HaNasi. So when I mentioned him, it wasn't just because of the person himself. Just we know that he was, the only thing that we know is that he was a scholar and seemingly a very decent person, and a person that was well liked by the people. And not only people that were around him, but because of the exchange of letters. From Spain, from North Africa, from Egypt, that he was significant and respected. He was just a kind of the last flicker of a candle that is going out. He was the last flicker. And in that sense, that mentioning him was, he was the last man, and in this case we know, the last man, this was the end of a period. When he died, in fact he was killed, a period stopped. That's the end of it. The Gaonic period is no longer there. You have rabbis there. The Rosh Hagola is no longer in existence. You have political leaders and heads of communities all over the world. Some of them even lived in Baghdad. Before and many years later, but nothing in the same work of the power, the structure. There are some descriptions of the contemporaries. There are some books written by Jewish travelers of the time. And some of these books of the travelers are, some of them saw the last yeshivot, or the last Resh Galuta. And they describe it in a very vivid way because they were tourists. So they came, say, from Spain or from France, and they went to make a grand tour of Jewish places, Historia Parchi, Benjamin of Tudela. So they went and they left the writings, and some of them write about the yeshivot. At least they were impressed. They were impressed because it was some kind of a Jewish feeling that you have, it wasn't a independent, it was a state. It was perhaps an autonomy, but it was a, an autonomy that was living, vibrant, powerful, and it has its power and its glory. So, and the whole, there was a structure, and there were rules, and there were ways of how things go. And you knew that everything, see, we know, for example, that in those yeshivot, also in the, they had vast archives. None of it remained, but they had vast archives in which there were the what are called the memories and the histories of hundreds of years before were there in their archives. None of it survived. But it was, see, I'm speaking about a time in which you had something like a, it was the state. But it was, in a small way, there was a Jewish independence. And at least it was a Jewish entity that was, that had its political and spiritual leadership. And this was there. And it continued for many hundreds of years as a thing that was the source, in a way, the source of authority. See, the whole notion that there is a certain source of authority. The Rosh Gola could be a small man or a big man, but he was still what we really know now. Many people that have claims to be descendants of the King David, lots of people. Perhaps two, I mean, just as a, it's an anecdote, it's not a real good joke, but the last fellow that made such a claim was a fellow that lived in Netanya. He was a dentist by profession, and he proclaimed himself the King of Israel. Unluckily, he decided, I met him once, not I met him by chance, not by making a visit to his court, which he didn't. He was a dentist. And he also publicized after a few years that he's abdicating his position and places his son instead. So, okay, it says, incidentally, it's just as a story. Incidentally, I asked somebody of this family, what do they know about such a claim that they are coming from the house of David? And a fellow who was the uncle who said, my nephew just invented it. Okay, but I'm just saying that. There were such people. There were such people. I mean, perhaps here are also a number of people that may have such a claim. It is not the same thing. As I say, there was once a time, this Rosh Gola was a prince of the house of David, a descendant, direct descendant of the last king, the last surviving king of the kingdom of Judea. So there was something like this, that they had the feeling there is something that is our part of point of glory. See, there is somebody like this. The son of David still exists. And these great yeshivot were not just yeshivot. They were called what is called Yeshiva Shel Gola. When they say the name of this great yeshivot, Shuran Popatiza, as I said, the head of the yeshiva was, from this came the title, Rosh Yeshivat Gaon Yaakov. From this came the title Gaon. Gaon wasn't the title, but it was, the yeshiva was called Yeshivat Gaon Yaakov, which is, let's say, the yeshiva of the glory of Jacob. So, This disappeared. That was the tragedy. And so I think I mentioned Chizkiah HaNasi because it's some kind of, it's not just a tragic way he died. He joins a great number of Jewish martyrs during the ages. His martyrdom is not just a personal one. He died, and with him died this period of glory, as much as it was. It died with him, and what remained are the memories and perhaps sometimes the expectations. Perhaps we can rebuild it sometime.